Hi, my name is Maciek Pytel, and I'm a software engineer at Google, as well as a long-term contributor to Cluster Autoscaler. In this talk, I'm going to focus on Cluster Autoscaler and specifically its scale-down logic. But before I start, I wanted to mention that for the Q&A session at the end, I will be joined by other engineers from SIG-Autoscaling, and we will be happy to take questions about both Cluster Autoscaler and other components maintained by SIG-Autoscaling, such as HPA or VPA. In the past, we have done multiple deep dives during previous KubeCons covering Cluster Autoscaler. And I think we've done both some general overviews as well as talks focused on scale-up logic. I've linked some of them on my slide. This time, I'm going to focus on scale-down. And in order to make that possible, I'm going to assume a certain level of knowledge of Cluster Autoscaler and how it works in general. Just as a reminder, I'm going to do a quick high-level recap of Cluster Autoscaler. So first of all, Cluster Autoscaler's primary job is to provide nodes for all the pods running in the cluster so that they can schedule. It uses the scheduling requirements of the pods as a signal. So it looks at things like pods declared resource requests, CPU requests, memory requests, and so on, as well as things like node affinity, node selectors, pod affinity, and any other scheduling constraints. What it does not look on are actual metrics like real CPU usage of node or real memory usage. And I also wanted to quickly cover one more Cluster Autoscaler concept, which is a node group. A node group is a resizable set of identical nodes. And this is how Cluster Autoscaler interacts with the underlying cloud by modifying the node groups. And the node group is mapped to different concept on each cloud provider. So for example, on AWS, it can be something like ASG. On GCE, it's a MIG, a managed instance group, and in something like Cluster API, it can be a machine deployment. With that in mind, let's move on to scale down. And I think the most important thing about Cluster Autoscaler scale down is that Cluster Autoscaler looks to remove specific nodes. It always operates on the level of node. It does not try to calculate a desired size of a node group. And why is that, right? Let me give you an example. So let's say we have four nodes that I have on this slide. And I already have different pods running on those nodes. And the different dimensions of the pods and nodes represent different resource requests. For example, we can imagine that on horizontal axis, we have a CPU. And on the vertical axis, we have memory. So the wider pod would request more memory. And the node would have finite resources. Basically, its height and width would represent how many cores it has and how many gigabytes of memory it has. So initially, we have four nodes in this example. And the question is whether three nodes would be enough to run all the pods. Or in other words, can we remove one of the nodes? And to answer that question, I'm going to try and remove one of the nodes, and then try to simulate what the scheduler would do in order to see if all the pods would still be able to schedule in the smaller cluster. Let's say I'm going to start with node A and just basically see what happens if I try to remove that node. And I've done some simulated scheduling, and I can see that, in fact, every single pod that was previously running on the node A could run on some other node in the cluster. So the answer to my original question is yes, three nodes are enough if we remove node A. However, let's try to remove node B now and do the same scheduling exercise. And this time the result is different. The pod E can still schedule on node A. However, pod D would remain pending in this scenario. And the reason for that is while there are enough overall resources in the cluster to satisfy its requirements, those resources are fragmented between multiple nodes. And there is not a single node with enough free resources for pod D to schedule. So as we can see, the result of scale down, or whether we can perform a scale down safely, would actually depend on which node we choose to scale down. And for that very reason, Cluster Autoscaler doesn't look at the entire cluster of the entire node group. It looks at each individual node, and for each node, it tries to answer the question whether this node can be deleted. And in order to do that, it looks at three basic criteria. So first of all, it checks whether a node can be deleted at all. It looks at something called utilization thresholds. And it also checks if all the pods currently running on the node could be scheduled on some other nodes in the cluster. I'm going to drill down into all those criteria in a second. But for now, let me mention that in order to delete a node, Cluster Autoscaler needs all those criteria to be continuously met for 10 minutes. OK, now let's look at those individual checks done by Cluster Autoscaler. So first of all, Cluster Autoscaler would go and check whether the node can be deleted at all. There are multiple reasons why even an empty node could not be deleted. One of those reasons could be the mean size constraints that can be defined for each node group. Cluster Autoscaler would, of course, not violate such constraint. And so it would not delete a node if it was blocked by minimum size. We also have an annotation which can be put on a node to opt it out from scale down. And I think the most common reason why a node would not be eligible for scale down is because it runs a pod that cannot be restarted. And there are a few categories of such pod. So by default, Cluster Autoscaler will not restart kubesystem pods. And the reason for this is this may cause some sort of cluster-wide disruption that we want to avoid. So for example, restarting metric server can potentially bring down HPAs in the cluster for a while, and restarting other system pods may have some other cluster-wide consequences. Cluster Autoscaler, depending on how it's configured, may also not delete pods with local storage for the fear of losing some data. And Cluster Autoscaler will also not delete a pod that is not owned by a controller, such as deployment. And the reason for that is the Cluster Autoscaler is actually deleting pods and not restarting them. It relies on deployment or similar controller to recreate the pod. So if it were to delete a node, a pod that is not managed by a controller, there is no guarantee that pod would actually be recreated by anything else. All those checks could be bypassed using the save to evict annotation. That annotation can be placed on a pod and basically gives you a way to explicitly say whether a pod can be restarted or not. So that's the first criteria. The other criteria we have is utilization thresholds. First of all, let me start by defining what I mean by utilization in this context. As I said in the beginning, Cluster Autoscaler doesn't look at actual utilization of the node. What it looks at is basically sum of all the requests of all the pods running on the node divided by node allocatable. So for example, if I have two pods that request half a CPU, and those pods are both running on a node with two CPUs, they would have that node would have a 50% utilization, because two times half a CPU gives me full CPU, which is 50% of two CPUs available on that node. And you can configure a utilization threshold where Cluster Autoscaler would not delete a node that is below that above that utilization threshold. So, for example, if the utilization threshold for CPU was 50%, Cluster Autoscaler will not delete any node that has above 50% CPU utilization. And this is separately checked for CPU, memory, and GPU. And different thresholds can be configured. I'd like to quickly touch on the reason for this logic. The idea here is that in order to improve utilization, we have to cause a certain level of disruption by restarting the pods. As the cluster average utilization increases, there is a diminishing return on further scale downs because the utilization is already quite high. And at some point, it may not be worth the extra disruption cost. And that moment will differ between clusters with different use cases. So for example, on one extreme, we may have a very static cluster, which almost never changes and has the same exact set of pods for a very long time. And just restarting them all a few times to get optimum utilization may be very much worth it. At the other end of the spectrum, we have a batch cluster, which is constantly being resized to run different sorts of batches. And where restarting those pods may not be worth it if they are expected to end by themselves very soon anyway. And so with utilization thresholds, you can control how aggressive the scale down will be. And the final check is what I also touched on in my example in the beginning. And it's a check whether all the pods running in the cluster on the node can run elsewhere in the cluster. And this is done exactly as I did it in my earlier example, by pretending to remove a node and asking embedded scheduler code whether it would be able to schedule all the pods previously running on that node on some other nodes in the cluster. So let's look at one more example. Let's say I want to delete node C. And it meets all the criteria I discussed before. So in this case, we can see that I could, in fact, delete this node because the only pod running there, pod E, could be rescheduled on node B. However, if node B was deleted, either by scale down or maybe by some other logic, maybe manually by the user, node C could no longer be scaled down. And Cluster Autoscaler keeps track of this information in order to avoid doing a scale up, which is no longer safe. Now let's consider a similar example with node B. Once again, the pod D that is running there could be rescheduled to node A. And once again, if node A was deleted, Cluster Autoscaler remembers that it was going to remove node B by moving pods to node A, and therefore it may no longer be safe to delete node B. In that particular case, it is actually still safe to do this because the pods could also be moved to node C. And Cluster Autoscaler will figure that out. However, the 10-minute deletion timer, which I mentioned earlier, would be reset in this case because Cluster Autoscaler only keeps track of a single way of deleting a node. And it no longer has the level of confidence if that particular destination is gone. Right, so now that we quickly covered the algorithm, I wanted to touch on some limitations of the scale down logic. And I think there are two major limitations that it currently has. So the first one is that Cluster Autoscaler can only drain one node at a time. And when I say drain, I mean the process of tainting the node and deleting all the pods running on the node, which can take some time. Cluster Autoscaler can delete multiple empty nodes in parallel though. And a node that only runs daemon set would be considered empty in that context because the daemon set doesn't need to be rescheduled elsewhere in the cluster. What that means is that deleting empty nodes is many times faster, more than 10 times faster in most configurations, than deleting nodes that run some pods. And in very large cluster, it can be very important to optimize the scale down by just making sure that the pods terminate in a way that leaves a lot of empty nodes that can be scaled down quickly. This is less relevant in a cluster with maybe dozens or 100 nodes, but becomes very important when we look into thousands of nodes. Another limitation is that Cluster Autoscaler cannot scale up and scale down at the same time. It can scale up multiple different node groups. It can scale up the same node group multiple times before completing the previous scale up. It can also scale down multiple empty nodes in parallel, as I described. However, it cannot combine scale up and scale down. So if one node group is scaling up, this will unfortunately block the scale down of any other nodes in the cluster. Right, so how can we optimize scale down, maybe tailor it to our specific cluster? First of all, there are multiple flags that Cluster Autoscaler exposes. Some of the most commonly configured flags, I would say, are those related to how long we wait before deleting a particular node. This is the 10-minute time that I mentioned before. It can be configured with a flag to any duration. There are also some additional flags that allow us to temporarily pause scale down after a certain event. Maybe if we try to delete a node and failed, we want to back off for a while, or maybe we don't want to scale down immediately after scale up. Another thing that can and often is worth configuring is the utilization thresholds I described earlier. There are also many other much more subtle flags that can control cluster autoscaler scale down behavior. But I want to give maybe a word of warning about configuring them. I would recommend a lot of caution and careful testing, because as SIG-Autoscaling, we don't necessarily test all those flags. And there are some combinations which may lead to various problems. So one example I've seen quite a few times is increasing the number of empty nodes that can be deleted in parallel by Cluster Autoscaler can, in some scenarios, exhaust cloud provider API call quota. And this will block scale down because Cluster Autoscaler can no longer make API calls. And it can also cause all sorts of other problems. So in this case, the result may be, in fact, slowing down scale down quite significantly, which is the opposite of what changing the flag was meant to do. Another common optimization that I would recommend considering is grouping different pods on separate node groups, so on separate set of nodes. And this can be achieved probably in many ways. The way I would recommend is using a combination of label and attained on the node, and then a node selector and toleration on the pod. So node selector and label guarantees that the workload goes onto the node group it's meant to go onto, and attained prevents any other pods from going onto the same node group. And the common use cases for actually grouping pods like this is, for example, running a batch, especially a large one. If the pods in the batch are likely to end at the same time, this is likely to leave the nodes completely empty, which will, as I described earlier, result in much faster scale down of all those nodes. Another common setup is running pods that cannot be restarted, such as kube system pods, but maybe also some stateful pods, maybe some databases, pods that generally cannot be restarted on a separate node pool. And the idea here is those pods would block scale down, and we don't necessarily want them to block scale down of nodes running other pods. So it may be very effective to just spread them on a separate node pool that will never scale down, but it will leave the other node pools free to scale down more easily. However, there is a cost to all of that. The more we partition our workloads into different separate nodes, the more we limit the bin packing opportunities available to Kubernetes scheduling. So this type of optimization tends to be more worth it in a cluster that scales up and down rapidly, and where the scale down speed is important, and maybe less efficient in a cluster where which is very static, and where the final efficient configuration that is reached slower may be preferred. So this is, I think, what I wanted to say about the scale down logic of Cluster Autoscaler. I also quickly want to touch on our SIG Autoscaling. We maintain Cluster Autoscaler, but we also work on other components, such as Pod Autoscalers, horizontal and vertical Pod Autoscaler. We meet every Monday at 4 p.m. Central European. And we have our own Slack channel, which I would like to welcome you to. And with that, I'm happy to take some questions now. As I said, the questions about all autoscalers are welcome. Thank you very much.